Welcome back. The ability of these seedables to grow despite of the climate change and also the distribution is something we're learning in this segment.
You want us to talk about seedables. What's the concept of the brains behind seedables?
So the Seedball Project has evolved through Cookswell's work in doing reforestation with the idea of how do you actually grow trees for charcoal? Because if you want firewood and charcoal to be a sustainable and renewable resource, you simply have to grow more trees.
Yeah.
In the mid-1990s, my late father and the owner of Carnivore, Martin Dunford, you know the Carnivore restaurant, they use a lot of charcoal for Nyama Choma. So between the two of them, they've been very interested in thinking, how do we actually make sure charcoal is sustainable in the future? And so we started doing all these different experiments on planting trees in dry land parts of Kenya. Mm-hmm. As many people will know, a lot of the charcoal for Nairobi comes from places like Mwingi, Kitui, Kajiado, and Narok. So we have a small demonstration woodlot where we started doing trials for tree planting in Kajiado. And what we found was there wasn't very much information on the best way for planting these dry land trees. When we started doing all these different tests, you know, some people said, dig a hole that's round and 2 feet wide. Other people said, don't do that. You have to dig a square hole that's 3 feet deep. You know, so we did all of these different trials over the years. What I started noticing, though, once we'd really perfected our traditional tree planting method of raising tree seedlings in a nursery in the plastic bags, transplanting them, digging the holes, planting, was that on scale, when you wanted to think of planting 100,000 or a million or 10 million trees, it started to become very cost prohibitive. What I was noticing on driving around Kenya in my work and visiting different places is that on the side of the highways and all of the main roads, you find so many natural acacia trees are growing and are sprouting up completely by themselves in the wild, to the point that even the highway authority actually pays people to cut them down. And this sort of came to a T once when we were had a planting contract, and on one side of the fence we were digging holes and planting trees for 30 shillings each. On the other side of the fence was the highway, and I was watching the highway guys cut down these trees, the same species that we were planting, and so that made me really think, you know, what's going on here? So we did some research on those trees growing on roadsides, and we found that it's the sand lorries taking that river sand for the building industry. As it's driving on the highway, the seeds are blowing out in the wind, landing on the side of the road, and some were germinating and growing. So I went to Kafri and I bought a whole bunch of seeds and I broadcast them. And it was similar to this year where the rain was quite delayed and it wasn't on time. And when I went back to see the site where I broadcast the naked seeds, I found that almost all of them had been eaten by insects and birds and mice. So that led me to thinking, how do we actually coat these tree seeds with a protective coating that's, you know, a safe, non-toxic protective coating? So I approached an old family friend and business partner named Elson Karstad from Chardas Limited. They deal with making the charcoal briquettes, you know, the ones that are remade from the dust. He started this industry of doing the charcoal briquettes back in the 1990s, buying this waste charcoal from people on the side of the road where they were selling all of the waste that's left over. He started buying it, making it into the briquettes. So as a very good engineer, I asked him, how could we use this waste charcoal dust to coat a seed on the inside of it? And you can see, here's one right here. And so he's made a machine that can do about 700 kilos a day. And as we need more, we just add more machines. So the idea of being able to do them on scale, it was a very interesting aspect with the Seedballs program. And when we look at the size of Kenya, a lot of these areas that have been really hit by charcoal making deforestation, being able to plant, you know, 100,000 acres, cost is really one of the main concerns with all of that.
So Teddy, if I could, given that this is a seed that can adapt to any climate.
So what it is that it's the seed coating, the charcoal dust, protects the seed from being eaten by mice or birds. Now, depending on what type of seed you use, you have to match the seed to the area you're planting. So what we always ask any of our customers who say, I'd like to plant some trees, we always ask them, what are people cutting down in your neighborhood? Plant more of those ones. Because the indigenous trees that are being made into charcoal, mm-hmm. when you match them to the same location, it means that they're able to grow in those areas and people understand their economic and social value and use. Mm-hmm. And so at the moment we are making about 14 different species of indigenous trees to Kenya. We're also doing 3 types of indigenous grass as well. There are many areas that we found people needed grass just as much as they needed trees for rehabilitating degraded areas.
So far, how do you distribute this thing?
So with the distribution, when we started looking into it, we decided how could we piggyback this onto existing logistics chains. So we've worked with so many different good companies all over Kenya. Mm-hmm. People like the MICE organization for workshops, Let's Go Travel. And what they'll do is when they're going to an area that they know acacia, Xandofolia yellow fever tree is being cut for charcoal making, they'll take those same seeds with them and engage with the local community or their guests in reseeding the areas that need it. We've been able to work with all sorts of people from private sector to public sector to conservation organizations, NGOs, and we just have people who, especially in areas, this isn't a full replacement for all types of tree planting, of course. Because you can't do mangoes, you can't do avocados, whatever, seed balls. What this is really best for are those hard-to-reach areas where the traditional type of tree planting is too expensive.
Yeah.
And so anywhere that things like charcoal making, overgrazing has taken place a lot, seed balls are a very, very good tool for helping rehabilitate those places.
So have you achieved, given that you know Kenya has a 7.5% forest cover, with this, can we achieve afforestation to 10%?
This will be one of the tools that help, definitely. I think when you look at the scale of the problem, there's no one single solution. It's a multiple angles in order to help us recover and rehabilitate our environment.
Mm-hmm.
This will definitely be a very helpful tool, and we're seeing it used more and more in these dry lands and hard to reach areas where people need to do massive reforestation.
All right. Teddy, someone probably might be asking, when you collect these seeds, how do you ensure that? How do you identify this is acacia, this is acacia draconolobium, this is, you know, Croton megalocarpus, something like that? How do you?
So what we do, and we'll continue to always do, is we buy all of our seed from KEFRI, the Kenya Forest Research Institute. They test all of the seeds to the International Seed Standard Association.
Mm-hmm.
They do all the viability and background. When you look at each of the drums, it actually has a batch number.
Yes.
That batch number helps us trace it back to the original seed orchard.
Mm-hmm.
The benefit with working with KEFRI is they are the only ones mandated to do all of the scientific steps that are required with tree seed collection and processing. This will be one of our future goals, is being able to buy more seed from KEFRI. Because the more seed, so not only spreading these seed balls, getting the right type of seed to the right place, but the more tree seeds we buy, the more people in areas where there is a lot of deforestation have an option for making money from their forests.
Mm-hmm.
And rather than cut down the trees for firewood or charcoal, if you're able to sell the seeds, you leave your trees standing.
And you do monitor it. Do you monitor this? How, if they're growing, how do you do that?
Yeah, so you get through feedback, through customers. Like you've just told me you have some tree seeds coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Where did you plant them?
In Kajiado.
In Kajiado. Yeah. So doing that type of feedback and monitoring is very helpful, as well as site visits. When some of our larger seeding sites, we're able to physically go and actually count and analyze.
Mm-hmm.
And we have an ongoing 3-year trial at the moment with the Kenya Forest Research Institute in Kitui. KEFRI has been absolutely critical for this entire seed ball process because they provide the seeds and they provide high quality, tested, clean seeds.
All right. Yeah. So many thanks, Teddy, for making it happen. Doing a great job. Once again, thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very
much. And this is awesome.
Good,
Who would have thought there's a certain way we can, you know, ensure that trees can grow despite all the climate?
Yeah. Well, what we always remind ourselves as well is, if you look at so many of these trees we've cut for charcoal, who planted them in the first place?
Uh-huh.
You know, the trees we've been cutting for 100 years were mostly planted naturally by a lucky seed falling in the right place, just like in the parables. And so I think we have a lot to learn from nature, and being able to mimic and assist natural regeneration is really key in hitting some of these targets for forest cover.
Well, I hope you've learned something today. As I've always told you, if you really want to make an impact, find your broom.